Welcome back. This is Dr. Linda teaching you strategic change management. Now we're going to be going through how do people decide to resist change? What is the model? Sorry about that. Model of employee decision to actively resist organizational change effort. Now, resisting change efforts is an emotional process just as much as it is a rational process. It is an emotional process because it involves or it depends on the emotional reaction that the person who is supposed to change gets with the change process. Whenever they are introduced to the change, what kind of emotional reaction does this person have? The emotional reaction that they have is influenced by how they discover the information about change. Do they discover the information about change through a formal method, mechanism, like a memo? Or is it through grapevine? It's very important that you understand how to package information so that it can have a positive emotional reaction with your employees, you know, or with your organizational members. That way, they can support the change processes. They can actually see that the change processes are also serious. The next thing you need to ask yourself is what kind of an environment is our organization operating in? Do you have an open environment or do you have a closed environment? The kind of environment that the organization has will influence the kind of emotional reaction that the organizational members have. The kind of informational cues that your members have, what have they heard about the change? How was change handled the other time when you've heard it before? Did it resort to job losses? Did it resort to undesired outcomes? All that results to an emotional reaction. Now, once there's this emotional reaction, the employee or the member decides or fails to decide whether to resist the organizational change effort. And the way they decide this, they do a quick assessment of the impact of resistance. And this is where the employee asks, if I continue resisting this change, are there consequences attached to it? If they realize that there are no consequences or the consequences are very minimal, they can as well resist the change. How about the effort required? Will they require to earn or to get new skills and new abilities? Will they require that they go back to school? Will they require that they do more learning? Now, if the organizational members do not have that learning culture and there are no consequences attached, somebody is likely to resist the change effort. How about their personal view of their own competencies and confidence? Are they competent? Are they confident? Could be you're introducing a change in terms of digital literacy. Maybe you want them to adopt some technology. What is their skill level? If it is limited, they're likely to resist change. How about the risk involved? You know, assessment of the risk involved. And this is where the person evaluates the risk of either accepting or rejecting the change. And all that results to resistance to change our behavior. So this is something that I would want you to think about as an individual. What is your story as regards to change management? Are you the people, are you the kind of person who resists change? Or are you more accepting of the change processes? Are you immune to change? Does change evoke fear or does it bring excitement? Do you love change? What are you doing or not doing that is keeping your commitment from being fully realized? What are your competing commitments? What are your big assumptions? And in line with that, I would wish to share examples of evaluating how immune is a person to change. Now, we have three people here. We have Helen, we have Bill, and we have Jane. Now, Helen has stated her commitment. She has stated that I am committed to taking the new initiative. Now, what is Helen intending to do? What she's going to do to help her keep committed is that she does not push for top performance. So she does what she's not doing is that she doesn't push for top performance from team members or herself. She quickly accepts mediocrity, mediocre products and thinking too often, and she doesn't prioritize. That is one of the main challenges of Helen. Now, Helen is committed to change, and this is one of the things that could be competing with her commitment to change. I'm committed to not upsetting my relationship with my boss by leaving the mentored role. And that's why when she realizes the competing commitment, she realizes that is the reason why she resists the change of a new initiative. That is why she is so willing to accept mediocrity. She does not want to rub feathers with her boss. Her assumption, she assumes that the boss will stop supporting her if she moves towards becoming his peer. She assumes that she doesn't have what it takes to successfully carry out a cutting edge project. Now, assume Helen works in your department. How would you help Helen? How would you help Helen so that she can take initiative, so that she's no longer feeling insecure in the organization? What if you are the boss? How do you ensure that this assumption that Helen has is actually nullified and that you are inviting her to the table to become a peer? What is the role of a change agent in that kind of a situation? Let's look at Bill. Bill is a team player. However, there's one thing that he doesn't do as often or is not committed to doing. He feels that he doesn't collaborate enough. He most of the time takes unilateral decisions, and he doesn't take people's input into account. Very selfish, sort of. Now, why does Bill behave this way? What are his competing commitments? He wants to be the one getting the credit. He also is trying to avoid frustration and conflict that come from collaboration. And so he finds it easier to make unilateral decisions. Now, what kind of assumptions does Bill have? Bill has made the assumption that no one will appreciate him if he's not seen to be the source of success. He assumes that nothing good will come from being frustrated in a conflict. So how does he manage that? By being unilateral in decision making. Assume Bill is one of your general managers and he's supposed to be engaged in a project where he has to work with other people. How would you help Bill overcome his fears so that he can stop resisting the change processes? Now, let us look at a person called Jane. Jane would wish to turn around her department. Well, but what is stopping Jane from doing that? Too often, she lets things slide. She's not proactive enough in getting people to follow through with their tasks. What are the competing commitments? Now, Jane, in as much as she would wish that she turns around the department, Sometimes the competing commitment is that I'm committed to not setting full sail until I have a clear map of how we get our department from here to there. She wants to see the bigger picture. And without the bigger picture, she cannot move. And the reason why she has that kind of competing commitment is that she makes this assumption that if I take my group into that deep water and discover I am unable to get us to the other side, I will be seen as incompetent leader who is undeserving of trust or responsibility. And so because she is afraid of that, she is afraid of being seen to be incompetent and undeserving of trust, which she really values. She would rather be not proactive, not take initiative. Definitely, she will not turn around the department. So how would you encourage Jane? What could you talk to Jane about so that she can be able to overcome this fear of not having to see the entire staircase before taking the first step? And this is now where we go to our own selves. I would want you to review your own story. Look at your own organization. What is your story? How immune to change are you? How immune to change are your organizational members? What are you doing, not doing, that is keeping your commitment from being fully realized? I want you to review that. What are your competing commitments? And what are your big assumptions? I hope by the time we are meeting in the next class, that you'll have reviewed that for yourself. How immune to change are you? What commitments are making it impossible for you to actually not do that which you wish to do? What are your competing commitments? And what are your big assumptions? Until then, have a wonderful time, and I hope you subscribe to our channel, Learning with Dr. Linda. Thank you, and see you in the next class.